where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way. He will make a way.
I'll do that one more time.
Oh, God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way. He will make a way. Seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide. Hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day.
Maybe let's just sing this together.
He will make a way.
Just speak over your situation. Say, God will make a way. Here we go.
Say, God will make a way. Where there seems to be. He works in ways we cannot see.
Good morning and welcome everyone. For all those who were brave enough and well enough to venture out this morning, it's good to see you. Our hearts are with the Van Pelt family this morning. We just ask the Lord to be close to them and give them comfort. And we are going to start out with the number 10 in your books here in this place. If you'll stand with us and sing together this song, we'll do all four verses.
It's the new light is streaming. Now are the shadows vanished away. See in this space our fears and our dreamings. Brought here to you in the light of this day. Gather us in the lost and forsaken. Gather us in our spirits in flame. Call to us now and we shall awaken. We shall arise at the sound of our name. We are the young, our lives are a mystery. We are the old who yearn for your face. We have been sung throughout all of history, called to be light to the whole human race. Gather us in the rich and the haughty. Gather us in the proud and the strong. Give us a heart so meek and so lowly. Give us the courage to enter the song. Here we will take the wine of compassion. Here we will take the bread of new birth. Here we become the people you fashion, children of God to be salt for the earth. Give us to drink the wine ever flowing. Give us to eat the bread that is you. Nourish us well and guide us in growing lives that are holy and hearts that are true. Not just in buildings dim and confining, not in some heaven light years away. Here in this place the new light is shining. Now is the dawning and now is the day. Gather us in and hold us forever. Gather us in and make us your own. Gather us in, all peoples together, fire of love in our flesh and our bone.
You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to welcome everyone to Midway this snowy morning, and there are a few announcements I would just like to make sure we highlight. The Midway annual members meeting will be today after the service, and that will follow a brief sack lunch, and then we will meet back here. Today is also the deadline to sign up for the Midway retreat on March 1 to 3rd in Walnut Creek. And there should be a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board, and there will need to be a $50 deposit per room per night.
I might add to that, we do really need to know your interest. If the $50 today, if that's a problem, we might have a week or two leeway, but we need to know if interest or that the retreat cannot happen. Thank you.
So please join me in the call to worship, and it should be projected on the wall above. I will be reading the leader sections, and you will respond with the sections titled All. Today, we celebrate a special baptism, the baptism of Jesus of Nazareth. God says, "Look, see my chosen servant, the one in whom I utterly delight. I have placed my spirit on him.
He will bring true justice to the nations."
When Jesus was baptized, the heavens opened up, and Spirit came down like a dove, And there was a voice from heaven saying, "This is my dearly loved Son,
with whom I am delighted."
The joy of the Lord, will be with you all.
And also with you.
Please join me in prayer. Most wonderful God, foolish and flawed though we are, we too delight in your beloved Son, as in his name we gather in the house of many praises. May the heavens be opened for us, that we may catch a glimpse of the light and love that transforms our common days with a beauty not of our making, through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Ethan. This being Epiphany Sunday, many of the songs we chose were about Jesus being the light, of course, the light that led the wise men to Jesus. As I was, that last Sunday, Dale was listening to the worship that was coming from the Mennonite Church in Harrisonburg. And I heard this song, and I thought, that is such a beautiful song. And as we were planning to choose songs for the month of January this past week, I thought of it for Epiphany. It's actually entitled as one of our Epiphany songs in our books. It's number 274, if you want to turn to it. But it's a beautiful tune and words, and just think about them. It is new, a new song for most of us, but just try and just place yourself in this song and enjoy and let it minister to you.
See whose glory fills the skies, Jesus, the light of the world, Son of righteousness, arise, Jesus, the light of the world. We'll walk in the light, beautiful light, shine where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, shine all around us by day and by night, Jesus, the light of the world. Pierce the gloom of sin and grief, Jesus, the light of the world. Scatter all my unbelief, Jesus, the light of the world. We'll walk in the light, beautiful light, shine where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, shine all around us by day and by night, Jesus, the light of the world. More and more thyself display, Jesus, the light of the world. Shining to the perfect day, Jesus, the light of the world. We'll walk in the light, beautiful light, shine where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, shine all around us by day and by night, Jesus, the light of the world. Visit then this soul of mine, Jesus, the light of the world. Fill me radiant and see divine, Jesus, the light of the world. We'll walk in the light, beautiful light. Shine where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world. Jesus, the light of the world.
Thank you. As with gladness men of old did the guiding star behold. Number 277.
With gladness men of old did the guiding star behold, as with joy they hailed its light, leading onward, beaming bright. So most gracious God, may we evermore be led to with joyful steps they sped, Savior, to thy lowly bed, there to bend the knee before thee, from heaven and earth adore. So may we with willing feet ever seek thy mercy seat. As they offered gifts most rare at thy cradle rude and bare, so may we with holy joy, pure and free from sin's alloy, all our costless treasures bring, Christ to thee, our heavenly King. Holy Jesus, every day keep us in the narrow way, and when earthly things are past, bring our ransomed souls at last, where they need no star to guide, where no clouds thy glory hide.
Shine, Jesus, shine.
Want the children to come up.
This is the children's song? I believe it is. Yes, children, come on up. The instruments are there on the bench for you.
Presence from the shadows into your radiance.
Children may stay up here for children's story time.
So nice to see all of you here today. Happy Epiphany, everybody. Are you ready to celebrate? So during this season of Advent that we had before Christmas and these couple Christmases after, or days after Christmas, Sundays after Christmas, during the children time, if you've noticed, I've been doing things with our senses. Like the first week, we smelled our yummy cookies. And the second week, we touched those balloons and Legos. And the third week, we tasted the yucky chocolate, but then the yummy chocolate. And last week, we used our ears to listen to some sounds. Do you know what sense we haven't done yet? What? Our seeing, our sight, right? So I have something that I want you to look at. It's here in this box. Now, this looks like it's a box that I bought some plastic knives in, but there's no plastic knives in here now. There's something else in here, and I want you... There's a hole right here at the end. Do you want to look and see if you see anything? How about you? No?
Really? I just see pitch black.
Pitch black? Oh, no. Why can't you see anything inside, you think? Why?
Because it's so tiny, it's hard to see through.
You think it's because it's... dark inside this box, isn't it? So what if, maybe if I shine a light, I have another hole here on the top of the box. I'm going to shine a light into the box. Can you see something inside now? Can you see something, yes or no? Can you see something?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Can you see in that hole?
Yes, I can see something that's...
inside. Here, do you want to see? This is what you were looking at, these stars. So, the light helped you see in the dark. Being a light in the darkness is what God calls us to be. It's what we celebrate on Epiphany. Epiphany is the 12th day after Christmas. It's traditionally the time we celebrate the wise men following the star to find and worship baby Jesus. God sent them a star to follow through the darkness to find baby Jesus. The word epiphany means a revelation. It means a new understanding. And that's what baby Jesus was. God's way of giving us a new understanding of God's love for all people. Jesus is God's light. When we follow Jesus, we also become God's light in the world. In Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1, we read, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you." This means we're supposed to reflect the light and spread the light. We aren't supposed to just stand there in the glow. We're called by God to do something with this light. We shine God's love on others by helping them. We can shine God's love by sharing with people, by being a caring friend, by loving people, even maybe if they're mean to us or don't really love us back. So those are some examples of ways that we can share God's love to others. We're going to pray, and then I have something to send you home with. God, thank you for sending Jesus to be the light in our darkness. Help us also be your light to others in the things that we do and the things that we say. Amen. Can you guys form a line so I can hand you each something as you come up to me? So I have a glow stick for everybody. So you can remember that. What are we remembering? We're remembering that you are God's love to other people. So shine the light of Jesus wherever you go. 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 You can leave your crack until at nighttime sometime if you want so you can see them. But once you get yours, you can go back to your seat. Shine the light of Jesus wherever you go. Shine the light of Jesus wherever you go.
I will be reading the scripture today, and it comes from Mark chapter 1, verses 9 to 13, and this is the NIV version from the hymnal. You guys know what I mean. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love, with you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him.
Good morning to you all. I just want to begin by just recognizing the loss of our brother Albert. I got a chance to see Albert on, I guess it was Thursday morning, and he wasn't doing well, but certainly I don't think we're expecting him to die that quickly. And so we just want to really keep Lana and the Van Pelt family in our thoughts and prayers. I encourage you to, we'll have the service here next Sunday. It'll be at 3:30. So just want to let you know about that. So Happy New Year to y'all. any New Year's resolutions out there? I don't know if there are. I didn't think I was going to do any New Year's resolutions, but there's something almost irresistible to me about making a resolution. This idea when you arrive on January 1st that this thing you've been wanting to do, is perhaps something you've wanted to change in your life, that's been really challenging. All of a sudden, January 1st makes that seem, maybe it's possible. It's a fresh start. It's a new beginning. And I think there's something appealing about that. So after the the day after New Year's, I think it was Tuesday, I was here at church, and I thought, you know, I'm gonna try to get back to eating sugar only one day a week. So like Friday, oftentimes our family has dessert. Friday evening, we have a special meal. And I've aspired to do that in the past, and it hasn't really worked out very well. So the first day, I'm at church, and the funeral home had dropped off some chocolates before Christmas. I didn't have a chocolate. Did good. I got home, and I opened up one of our cupboards, and there were some mini M&Ms. And just like that, the resolution was done. It was like 5 hours. And here's the sad thing about it. I don't even really like M&Ms. Like mini M&Ms. I mean, they're not even that good. It'd been one thing if I would have succumbed to like really good dark chocolate or pie or ice cream or something, but mini M&Ms, it was just really a sad end to that resolution. So today, we kind of a couple things here going on in our service. Epiphany was marked this week, and also it's the day we recognize the baptism of Jesus, and that's where I'm going to be focusing today. And I think it's an appropriate passage for the first Sunday of the new year because it contains both a new beginning and temptation, these things that I mentioned that we often associate with the new year. And in the other Gospels, we get some background on Jesus, and especially Mark and Matthew and Luke. We find out Jesus' genealogy. We find out the circumstances of his birth. But in Mark's Gospel, if you notice, it's really abrupt. We don't get any of that. There's just this guy from the hills of Nazareth that kind of emerges in the mist, this solitary guy that steps into the baptismal line with the others to be baptized by John in the Jordan River. There's nothing that looks impressive about this guy. He doesn't come from an impressive place. Nazareth is kind of nowheresville. I don't think he probably looks super impressive. But there's something about that baptism. When he comes out of the water, that something dramatic does happen. The heavens are torn open. I want you to notice that. That's what Mark says. It's not that there's like this kind of gentle clouds that were kind of parting. No, Mark is very specific about his language. He says that the heavens are ripped open. Right? So sometimes we think about heaven as kind of up there, but I don't know, how far would you have to go up there to get to heaven? I think heaven is more the unseen realm of God. And so what's happening is this curtain is being pulled back, and just for a minute, the seen world, this world, and the unseen world, there's this gap, and it's been ripped open. There's been a curtain that's been torn open. Think about the difference between opening and tearing something. Something about like you unbutton your shirt and you rip it off like the Incredible Hulk, right? There's something different about that. There's something about when you rip something open that it's not going to be put back together easily. And in the Bible, often something cataclysmic is happening that can't be undone when that happens. As one person wrote, when Jesus comes out of the water, all heaven breaks loose. I like that. All heaven breaks loose. So through this tear, again, we've got this unseen world that's opened up, and through this tear in the fabric between the seen and the unseen comes the Spirit. It comes like a dove. It's not a dove, but it comes like a dove. And the impression that I often think about, maybe from my upbringing, is that the Spirit is very gentle, right? So oftentimes we would talk about like the Spirit nudges you. I don't know if anybody else used that language, or the Spirit kind of whispers something. This is not the gentle Spirit. Look at verse 12. At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness. And that word sent does not do justice to what the original language says. It's cast out. He's driven out, right? Kind of almost, it almost reminds me of somebody driving out livestock into the wilderness. Like it or not, you're going to the wilderness. And it's at once. Right? Jesus is baptized at once. There's no, I mean, think about the way we do baptisms here. There's no celebration. There's no gift. There's no carry-in meal, right, on the banks of the Jordan as we do. The Spirit wastes no time. Why? Because the Spirit wants to get Jesus out to meet Satan. Right? That's what happens here, isn't it? It's like quite a start to Jesus' ministry. And did you notice this little, this other little detail? Like Mark's account of the temptation is so much smaller, but he includes the wild animals, the wild beasts, as some translation. So Jesus he's driven out in the wilderness to meet Satan, and the wild beasts are there, which sounds pretty foreboding to me. So we have this scene kind of set, it's like an epic battle. There's this kind of rumble in the jungle, or rumble in the desert, if you want to call it. We have it in one corner, Jesus, newly baptized, supported by a crew of angels, and in the other, Satan and the wild beasts. I mentioned earlier there's something to me that's almost irresistible about New Year's resolutions. And I know I'm not alone, because I looked at a bunch of surveys. I looked at one survey and it said 37% of Americans had a goal they were going to achieve in 2023. And I don't think there'll be any big surprises here. This survey, here's the most popular one: save more money, exercise more, eat healthier, spend more time with family and friends, lose weight. And here's the statistic in this survey that really stood out to me. Of the people, I guess the 37% of people who said they were going to keep a resolution, 87% said they were very or somewhat likely to keep it through the year. It's like, yeah, we got no problem. I'm going to make this resolution, no problem. And like, either they must have a lot better track record of New Year's resolutions than mine, because it sounds completely delusional for me, for 87% of people to say, yeah, we got this. Right, and the reality is, it's like 1% will make it to 12 months, right? And yet, despite our abysmal track record, many of us, and I'm kind of one of them, will return again and again to these resolutions. Why? Why are they so irresistible to some of us? Well, I think for some of us, it offers a reset. That's not a bad thing. It's nice to have something come once a year where you can say, I'm going to put this behind me and I'm going to start over. I'm going to have a new beginning. And I think that's understandable. But I think for some of us too, there's this idea that if we look ahead and we look ahead to January 1st, 2025, and we imagine ourselves having accomplished that resolution, having accomplished that elusive goal that we struggle to do year after year, we can imagine how much better our lives are going to be. I mean, maybe if we peel back the layers a little more, if we kind of allow ourselves to be a little more vulnerable, we can think that if we can accomplish that elusive goal, maybe we'll arrive. Maybe we'll be enough. Like, there's this place on the horizon that in our minds, somehow the troubles will be gone, which is quite different than what we see, I think, in Scripture. Notice how complicated and difficult life Jesus gets after his beginning, after his baptism. We don't know a lot of details about his early life. We get some of them for the other Gospels, none in Mark's. But I think it's safe to say that Jesus' life gets a lot harder after his baptism. Like, he's barely even dried off from the water of the Jordan when the Spirit is driving him to meet Satan in the wilderness with wild beasts. If Satan doesn't scare you, how about the wild beast? Does that sound scary? I guess not. You guys must do that. You guys must go out into the wilderness with the wild beasts more than I do. I wonder if Jesus was ever like nostalgic about Nazareth. Like, I wonder if he ever wanted to go back to being a carpenter. Like a simpler life, small town, Galilee in the hills, working with his hands. It sounds kind of like should be a country song maybe in there somewhere. Simpler times. Because immediately after his baptism, he's got new challenges, he's got new temptations, he's got new problems. I think it's the same with us. Our baptism, our decision to unite our lives with Jesus Christ, to make this public profession of faith, I'm going to follow this guy, is a glorious event, and we should do. I really try to do everything we can to mark and celebrate anytime someone is baptized in this congregation, because it's a big deal. I want to make it even a bigger deal. But I think we need to recognize, and this is hard, baptism introduces new problems into our life, new challenges into our life, which is actually exactly what Jesus promised. In chapter 8 of Mark's gospel, which is the kind of the fulcrum, the midpoint of the gospel, Peter, has this incredible moment of clarity when he gets who Jesus is. You're the Messiah. You're the Christ. Right? It should be this moment of celebration. Finally, someone understands, except for, you know, the evil spirits seem to know who Jesus is, but now it's a disciple who understands who Jesus is. And then Jesus says, I'm going to suffer. I'm going to be rejected. I'm going to be killed. You want to be my disciple? You want to follow me? You're going to have to deny yourself, take up your cross, and die to yourself. So here's the challenge for me. That path, that beginning, that following Jesus is almost completely the opposite of the path that my New Year's resolutions are supposed to take me on. The path of my New Year's resolutions is supposed to move me to greener pastures, to greater things. It moves up and to the right to greater success. I don't want to deny myself. I want to improve myself. I don't want to lose my life. I want a better life. But here's another problem with this. If I can't make it 5 hours without collapsing in the face of many M&Ms, like, what chance do I have moving out into the wilderness and into this testing that comes as a disciple? Because I think we need to recognize that Jesus is being tempted. He's being tested. I want to say that again. Jesus is being tempted. I think it's easy to come to this passage and say, yeah, but he's the Son of God. How hard was it really to say no when you're the Son of God? Are you really tempted? Well, the gospel writer Mark uses the language of temptation because I think he believes that Jesus was really tempted. Right? For New Year's Day, we had black-eyed peas. It's my wife's tradition. I'm still not quite on board with it, but it's okay. All right, anybody else black-eyed peas on New Year's? I think it's a thing. Maybe it's in the South. I don't mind black-eyed peas. I'll eat black-eyed peas. They taste fine. The extras sat in our fridge all week. I got to tell you, I was never once tempted this week to, like, just consume those black-eyed peas, right? You just start with one spoon, and then you just can't stop. And before you know it, you've eaten the whole thing of black-eyed peas, right? Now, like, you Ben and Jerry's ice cream last night, I took one bite, and I wanted to eat the whole pint. I'm like, some people do that. I think it's okay to eat the whole pint. That is a temptation, right? Something's not a temptation if it doesn't tempt us. And I think if the Bible speaks about being Jesus being tempted, I think we need to assume that Jesus is being tempted and tested by Satan. So how's this going to play out? Jesus, the angels, Satan, the wild beasts. This is an epic clash. If you are a gambling man, bet on Satan. Bet on Satan. Because if you look back at the history of Israel, you will see an abysmal record in their ability to resist temptation. But the Israelites, you notice these number 40, it's kind of cluing us in. The Israelites wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, didn't do so well in their testing. The most epic failure, again, 40 days, number 40 again. Moses goes up on Mount Sinai, he's receiving the Ten Commandments. The ink has barely dried on the commandments. He comes back down, his brother Aaron has crafted a golden calf. They've broken the first commandment, right? Their record is abysmal. Others have failed. Others have always failed. And yet this solitary guy from Nazareth comes along. He takes the full brunt of Satan's onslaught. Satan throws everything he has at Jesus, and he succeeds. He succeeds where everyone else has failed. How does he do it? I think this is a really interesting thing about this passage. How is Jesus equipped to do that? If he really is being tempted, which I would say absolutely he's being tempted, then how has he been equipped to be resolute, to resist that temptation? Well, look at what the words come from. When the heavens are ripped open and this unseen world, these words come from this unseen world. Look at the words he hears. You are my son whom I love. With you I am well pleased. Right, this is critical that we see this. Jesus is driven into the wilderness to be tested, but he is equipped. How is he equipped? He's first told, you are my son. This is probably an allusion to Psalm 2, which is a psalm that celebrates the enthronement of a king to rule over God's people. And so Jesus is being told by the Father, you are the king that will rule over the people. And this is going to be important because as Jesus, at the beginning of his ministry, as he moves out into ministry, He's going to be constantly questioned about whether he really is a king, right? He doesn't look like a king. He doesn't look super impressive. He doesn't have an army. He doesn't rule the way kings do. I mean, at one point he's washing feet, not what we think about kings. People don't recognize him as a king, and when they do recognize him as a king at his crucifixion, they have a sign that says the king of the Jews, but they're mocking him, right? Lots of voices in Jesus' ministry are going to question him. Are you really a king? Where does your authority come from? Where did you get this authority? That's a question that Jesus is asked. And what Jesus does is he sends them back to his baptism. I'm secure in my authority because I heard the voice at my baptism. But he's not just told that he's a king, he's told that he's beloved. You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. Right? This is similar language if you actually look back at the story of Abraham, who takes his son Isaac up on the mountain. He hears the voice, take your son, your only son who you love. Right? So I want you to see in this baptism, this is a tender moment. Yes, there's going to be testing. It's going to be trouble, but the first thing is a tender moment between a heavenly parent and a child in which the father looks at the son and says, you are my dear, dear child. Eugene Peterson in The Message, he says it this way, you are my son, chosen and marked by my love, pride of my life. Right? So before Jesus is sent into the wilderness, he's equipped with the knowledge that he is the beloved son of God. And when Jesus gets to the wilderness, he confronts Satan. Guess where Satan begins to attack? I'm going to have to pop over to another gospel because we don't get this in Mark. I usually don't particularly love doing that, but we don't get a lot of details in Mark. What in Matthew's gospel, though, what are the temptations? Do you remember the first couple temptations to Jesus? They begin with the word if. If you're the son of God, right? Do you see what Satan's doing with this word if? He's trying to sow seeds of doubt in Jesus' mind. Jesus has just been baptized. He's just been given his identity. He's just been told he's beloved. He goes out and Satan says, if you are the Son of God, you just got baptized. You're in the wilderness. You're by yourself. You're hungry. What kind of loving father does that? Let's give Satan credit. I don't think Satan's going to waste his energy kind of jabbing, kind of attacking in areas that he doesn't think are where he's going to be able to land a punch. Like Satan doesn't, tempt us with black-eyed peas if we want nothing to do with black-eyed peas. Satan is going to look for an opening. He's going to look for what he thinks is a vulnerability. That's what he does with Jesus. You think you really are who you think you are? You really the Son of God? You really beloved? Really? Do you see? I mean, that's so often in the Bible the way Satan works. It's very subtle. Same thing in the garden. Did God really tell you this? It's very subtle. He tempts and Jesus resists. Again, everyone who has come before Jesus has failed, but the one that comes from the hills of Nazareth succeeds where all others have failed. He rejects the lies of Satan, and he instead holds fast to the truth that he heard from his father at his baptism. You are my son whom I love. With you I am well pleased. If Jesus has the security of the love of the Father, he has all he needs in the wilderness. And one of the beautiful and I think mysterious things that we read in Scripture is that somehow at our baptism, we are united with Jesus Christ. Paul tells us in Romans 6 when he says, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into, the key word there, into Christ Jesus, and were baptized into his death, right? And Paul says that when we are baptized into Jesus death, we are then baptized into his burial and his resurrection. We are raised to new life. We are a new creation. We have a new beginning. And because we are baptized into Jesus, who is the Son of God, we are then adopted as sons and daughters of God into this family of God. And this is important, right? Because now, as we are adopted into the family of God, as we are united with the Son, the words that are spoken to the Son are spoken to us. The Father looks at you, the Father looks at me and says, you are my son, you are my daughter, you are my dear, dear child, and I'm delighted with you. You're my beloved, you're marked by my love, you are the pride of my life. In other words, I think what we hear is you're enough. You see how differently this is than the way we typically operate in our culture. The way we tend to think, see things is if I can work hard enough, if I can make enough money, if I can get educated enough, if I can have enough success, if I can lose enough weight, if I can do enough exercise, at some point down the road, I'm going to be enough. I will have arrived. I'll be okay. And when I'm there, my problems will be gone. It's so different, the path of Jesus. The path of Jesus is you are beloved, and now you've got some new problems. But it starts with you are enough. Because Jesus and God know that if we are going to move out as disciples into temptation, we are going to have to know from the very beginning that we are enough. That is how we are to face the temptations and trials that we face as disciples. Right? Remember, Jesus says, you want to follow me? You're going to follow me into deserts. You're going to follow me into wilderness. You're going to have to deny yourself. You're going to have to lose your life. In this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. Yes, we will have trouble, but Jesus has entered into the trouble of the world, a fallen and broken, sinful world. He has faced the temptation and powers of darkness, and he has won the way back to the tree of life for his people, for those who put their trust in him. Right? The only way that we can follow after this Jesus is because he has blazed a path before us, and because he equips us for the journey. He gives us his spirit, and he gives us what I think we most desperately crave, to be enough, to be beloved. And T. Wright says it this way, if we start the journey imagining that our God is a bully, an angry, threatening parent ready to yell at us, slam the door on us, or kick us out into the street because we haven't quite made the grade, we will fail at the first whisper of temptation. But if we remember the voice that spoke those powerful words of love, we will find the way through. We will find the way through because we have heard the words, you are the beloved. And not only that, we have someone who gets us. Oftentimes when we think about our commitment to Jesus Christ, we think rightly of our commitment to Jesus as Lord and our commitment to our trust that Jesus is our Savior. We often, I think, forget that Jesus is our brother. Don't forget that Jesus is your brother. This is going to be really important. And this is why this is so important, that you understand that Jesus was actually tempted, because Jesus knows what it's like in the wilderness. Whatever you're facing right now is not a surprise to Jesus. He's been there, and he's with us now, right? If we read in that passage, one of the cool things is that Mark says is that the angels were attending. The angels were pouring out the love of the Father into the Son those 40 days. They helped see him through, and we trust that our brother Jesus will see us through our trials.
Our response song this morning is Come Holy Spirit, Dove Divine. This is in the Blue Hymnals, number 445. It's a familiar tune, but new words.
Come Holy Spirit, Dove Divine. On these baptismal waters shine, and teach our hearts in highest strength to praise the Lamb for sinners slain. We sink beneath the waters' face, and thank you for saving grace, we die to sin and seek a grave with you beneath the yielding wave. And as we rise with you to live, oh, let the Holy Spirit seal of blessing from above, the joy of life, the fire of
Lord God, we come to you in prayer. There is quite a bit that we can be thankful for, and there is quite a bit that we can pray about as well. And we lift that up into our thoughts and prayers as well. Prayer comes in many shapes and forms. With that said, we give thanks for the prayers of the people ministry that we have here at Midway. We may not typically think of this particular segment of our Sunday morning worship service as a ministry, but in a way it is. We think of it and pray for all who listen to these prayers. We pray for those who may not as well. Lord, thank you for listening to our prayers. We give thanks and think of all the various people that provide prayers for this portion of the service and other parts as well. We give thanks and praise for all the styles and blends of variety that form as a result. With that said, we also lift up our Thursday night prayer time. We are blessed by all who zoom in for it. May all be comforted. Yes, in a way, we are praying about praying. But yes, that is something that we can certainly pray about as well. It is a tool and a ministry as well. All are welcome to be a part of it. Some are more comfortable being involved with it, whereas others are unable to invest time into this due to other interests and commitments. We give blessing that this ministry that started on Monday evenings in person with the late Pastor Herman Myers has been able to continue on for the last 15 years. Hopefully it is something that can continue for as long as it can. When it comes to that prayer time, sometimes some may prefer to listen rather than to speak. As a song goes, Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Lord, thank you for handling our prayers and listening to our prayers. As we lift our thoughts, concerns, words of grace, and gratitude to you in prayer, we give thanks and admiration to you. During my interactions with people, I saw a lady wearing a shirt that said the following: they asked me why I pray, and I asked them why they breathe. Lord, thank you for every breath that we breathe. We lift up those of whom who are having breathing issues and who struggle with their breathing. I found out that this lady with the t-shirt attends a neighboring Mennonite church congregation. Thus, I feel it is fitting to lift up her church in Latonia into our prayers as well. We pray for all churches that are in leadership and or pastor search process. We lift up those continuing to serve in those or similar roles or capacities as well. And yes, we do give thanks when church congregations get a breather and do not need to go through that process. Lord, you have created a wondrous land far and wide. May we all take care of this wonder wall of an oasis, for there are many things that we would like to say and do to you, but sometimes we don't know how to proceed and do them. With your guidance, may we be saved from the obstacles that prevent us from seeing the clear picture of life's paths and send us on blinding and winding roads of distraction. Thank you for being a guide and special supernova in the sky. Lord, sometimes what we say makes sense, and sometimes it may not. With that said, Lord, thank you for creating all the creatures that you have created. We pray for all the storms that people are dealing with. We pray for all the response teams that are dealing with that. We also lift up the 3 C's food ministry, the rescue mission, the way station, and the transformation that they are going through at this time, Harmony Village, and the beloved residents that reside there and interact there, as well as God's choice and missions, ministries, and passions and other interests that come to mind as well. We think of the church affirmations and affiliations and decisions that are set to be made. God, we lift up all who we interact with regularly and occasionally. We lift up any prayer requests that we have been informed about. We think about this past year and look ahead into this new year that began recently. We lift up all that are dealing with coughs and sickness, or have dealt with it, or are beginning to deal with sickness. Places have been hit intensely recently with COVID. We pray for all who are dealing with that and other nightmares and difficult situations of uncertainty. We pray for the members' meeting that is coming up today. We pray for the upcoming retreat. We pray for those of whom who have keys to the church. May those who do not have keys have the courage to ask those who do for assistance to gain access when needed. We pray for the Al Van Pelt family, mourn the loss. We pray for those of whom who reside in assisted living homes, such as Catherine Yoder and Velma Blosser. We pray for our older members in their 90s, such as Art Blosser, Sarah Weaver, Lauren Bowman, Wilbur Yoder, Louise Culler, as well as our octogenarians, and those in their 70s, and people of all ages as well. We pray for Joe Scholl's sister, Lisa. Speaking of Joel Scholl, we lift up Elizabeth and Josiah as well. We pray for Kevin Blosser, as well as Michelle Moffitt. We lift up Ruth Keeler and family members. We think of Ruth's brother John, her sister Rachel, her daughter Eileen, her granddaughter Tara, grandnephew baby Marcus, and others as well. We pray for Seth Wolverton, as well as Harley Wolf and family, as well as Carol DeWitt, John Huffman, Diane Buzzard, and others that come to mind. We also want to take into consideration requests that may not be publicly known. We lift up those of whom who are with us today, as well as those who are elsewhere. May we all be blessed wherever we happen to be. We pray for Roger Weir and Millie Trotter's birthdays this week and any anniversaries on our minds. We pray for joys and happiness to replace the pains and sorrows that we may face. May we certainly give glory, honor, and respect to you in whatever that we may do. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Please pray with me for the offering. Lord, let our congregation be a witness to you. Immersed in scripture, constant in prayer, joyful in worship, generous in giving, a loving, supportive community, reach out to those in need. Accept these gifts we offer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our sending song this morning, we will do Jesus Be the Center. We want Jesus to be the center of our lives as we go from here. And let's all stand, please. Jesus, be the center, be my source, be my light, Jesus. Jesus, be the center, be my hope, be my song, Jesus.
Now may Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, and I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord.